truly honor this legend. He has been honored this evening, or will be at least honored this evening, as the master of music. He's been involved in the music industry for a whopping 47 years. Thank you so very much for agreeing to stay on and continue our discussion. What does it feel like to be referred to as a legend and to be honored in your lifetime while you're still around us?
It's a challenge, the same thing like receiving lifetime achievement award. Sometimes you think, oh, they're getting rid of me now. They're saying that we have had enough of you. Take a bow and get up. But being called a legend, it's one of those accolades that I treasure very much.
On the contrary, we want more, and we want to know if there's anything you're working on and what we can expect in the future.
There's a lot, there's much in the pipeline. It will be more based on collaborations, because I still feel that I need to nurture some young musicians, teach them the art of writing songs, because now there are no songs. What they're doing, they're just downloading beats. So we would like to carry on and give them encouragement to be better songwriters.
And to groom them, yeah. It's very important. Also on the business of music, you've traveled the world, literally. You've won local, international accolades. You've learned a few things, and I'm sure there's some experiences that you would want younger artists to try and avoid as much as possible, because you've been there and you've learned the hard way, and we can perhaps have an easier route simply by learning from you.
It's a responsibility. You are representing completely different people. The whole continent looks at you. Once you break into the international community, they'll say that, oh, he's an African. They don't say he's a South African. So automatically, the burden is too heavy. Only to find that sometimes you've never even ventured out into Africa. So we need to travel more. Respect the art. Your art is much more important than your personality, because you are as good as your last record. And be humble. Make sure that it's about us. Stop saying I. Learn French and say we.
And talking about we, it's very difficult to separate your name from that of Nana Coyote's in a sentence. It goes hand in hand. Both of you, phenomenal forces in the industry.
You know, it's so funny, because around the 70s, when we were the Cannibals, he used to be with a group called the Black Five from Sharpeville. And when we were touring Lesotho, they would be following us wherever we performed. And I started admiring his way of singing. And when I got back to South Africa, we lost trace of one another. He went back to Lesotho and joined Sankomota when Tshepo Tshola went to London with Hugh. And we took a tour with Steve Kekane. With the backing band of Steve Kekane, because Stimela grew up from being a giving band, working with almost everyone. Maybe that's why some of our vocabulary grew up much more better. Then we saw Coyote. I gave him the name Coyote, because the way he howled reminded me of a coyote.
He was like a coyote!
He was so given, because he joined Stimela. Stimela is a huge family. He joined Stimela in 1985. How so? I featured him on Look, Listen and Decide. And at first, he didn't want even to sing that part where he said, open them, son. I said, you are not about to uncover this at Tana Lima 13. No, the song requires that.
Yeah, that raspy that voice, yeah. Yes.
And that catapulted
my
him
goodness.
Which was good. Until his last days, we're still very much like that.
Yes.
It's like I lost my ego, because he was my alter ego, and I was his alter ego.
Yeah.
And we developed a way of entertaining than to be boring, you know.
Yeah. No, the two of you on stage were like little boys in a candy store.
Maybe that's why we had so much passion. Oh. For the audience, because we're enjoying ourselves.
Yes, and it showed.
So the audience gets more when we into ourselves.
Yeah.
Oh man, I'm glad that I'm in this field.
Listen, talking about little boys in a candy store, everybody in the studio has just been trying to guess your age and whether or not you've found perhaps a secret fountain of youth, because you're one of those people, we just don't see you aging. You're 67.
23rd of March 1947.
No way.
That makes me 67.
No way.
I need to collect pension for the past 7 years.
No, no, listen, you're far from retirement as far as we're concerned.
Who said I want to retire?
No, you must not. Just in case you were thinking about it, you're talking about collecting pension. So I just thought, let me respectfully call you to order and say not yet.
No, I have to collect pension. I've got grandchildren, so my grandchildren can benefit from that.
Wow. Know?
Whilst I'm busy playing my guitar at home.
You talking know? About family, your upbringing, you spoke to me briefly off air about perhaps something that could be linked to your boyish good looks. The fact that when you grew up, you had calcium deficiency. What was that?
Yeah. At the age of 4, I couldn't crawl or anything of that kind. And before my biological father passed on, they would turn me around and do all those kind of things until my mom got married to Phiri. Mm. And then Phiri noticed that there's something wrong with me. Mm. He's the one that got in touch with a doctor called Pulen. They did a battery of tests. Then they found that, no, I'm wasting all the calcium. Sure. From 1952 until up to 1961, I was in hospital all those times. You know. Sure. Then I started school at a very late stage. Mm. But my schooling started in hospital. There was this eccentric preacher man called Father Bernard, who used to teach me things and say, 1 + 1 doesn't make 2, it's 12. Because it's one stick,
yeah.
One stick, one stick, and one stick.
Okay. If
you, I said, how so? He said, no, there are 2 sticks, and there's 1 that goes in between. I said, no, it doesn't make sense. I said, yes, it is only 4 sticks, it's not 12.
Oh, my goodness.
So
you taught you to think out of the box
and, I started,
and not be mainstream.
Thank you.
Although it wasn't entirely correct, but he taught you to be, you know, to step back and look at things differently.
And he wanted me to challenge him on that. Mm-hmm. So if I believed in that, then he would have dismissed me.
Yeah.
Said, never stop being curious. Yeah. You must have a thirst, an unquenchable thirst for knowledge.
Yeah.
Singing with a fool is crime. But weeping with the wise is wisdom. So I would rather weep with the wise.
Oh, my goodness. And we're so glad he did that, because you've given us a fresh, unique genre, something beautiful to look forward to as South Africans. And we want to sample that. So I'm going to ask you, I know you're attached to a microphone right now. If you can take that microphone off and make your way to the area there where you're surrounded by one or two of your band members to help you in your bringing forth in your journey. You said we must speak French, no?
Oui, oui,
I. We are looking forward to that music. I believe you'll be playing Father.
Father. Paying homage to my old man, the Phiri that taught me music.
Ah.
I wouldn't be a musician. I wouldn't have been this individual that believes in us.
Wow.
So it's a way of saying,
well, thank God for Ubabu Phiri. There we go. Just enjoy this in the meantime while we try and get ourselves set up.
Some people